Thank you very much, Manzoor, for giving your time for the interview today. I think we wanted to start off with, I think you've got a vast amount of experience about what happened in Uganda, and I thought we'd start off with what you did in Uganda, what was your occupation and the kind of activities you conducted.
I was a company director of two companies, which were family-run companies, and I being the eldest son, my father had roped me into the business. I am, and I was, always an academic by inclination. I'm a graduate from a university, and I would have gone on to other things. I was going to go into medicine, for example, and I was given a place in a very good medical school in Pakistan, but I couldn't pursue my studies because my father forced me to join him in his business as I was the eldest son. So I then became a director in two family-run companies. We had motor showroom, workshops, motor spares, we did some insurance, and of course my father had expanded his property portfolio, so I managed his properties as well. So we had considerable interest in Uganda in different sectors of involvement, and I was kept busy, but I was never deeply interested in that aspect of my life. So I then indulged in politics of the country, and I became a local councillor at a very young age, and then gradually I became the first deputy mayor of my town, and I also stood for parliament in Uganda unsuccessfully, but my interest in politics was maintained and sustained throughout my life in Uganda, and I made some very good friends amongst the Africans, amongst the Asians, and amongst the Europeans, because I had a broad spectrum of friendship across the country.
And Manzoor, you were born in Uganda, am I right?
No, okay. I was born, was then British India, and when I was an infant, I travelled to Uganda with my mother. My father having preceded us, and therefore I grew up in Uganda. I had my education in Uganda up to the secondary level, and I did extremely well, and then I went on to Pakistan, and I did my degree in sciences at a very prestigious college, which was the best in Pakistan.
And let me, if I can, take you back to the period where Amin had taken power. You are one of the very few people that Amin had engaged with in terms of his policy engagements. Can you tell me when the start of your engagement with Idi Amin took place?
Yes, I mean, the Asian community in Uganda was under pressure from 1966 onwards. Uganda became independent in October 1962, when the country's population stood at just over 11 million people. Of the 11 million people, there were 60,000 Asians, and they lived comfortably until May 1966, although many of them had begun to leave the country after independence as they were not confident of the Africans treating them well after independence. So the Asian population began to be depleted after independence, and in May 1966, Milton Obote staged a coup when he overthrew the president of the country, who was the Kabaka of Buganda, and the reign of terror started under military rule, which was ordered by Milton Obote, the president of the country. Now, I remember distinctly, I was chairing a meeting of the Uganda Urban Authorities Association in Kampala, where all the local authority members had come to attend the meeting, and the coup started on that very day, and I remained stranded in Uganda, in Kampala, for 3 days. I could not go back to my hometown, Masaka. All telephone lines were cut, and after 3 days, I was able to travel back to my home with a military escort that was being provided by the military for a convoy of cars going to Masaka. Now, life became difficult for the Asians after that, because Milton Obote began targeting the Asians, threatening them with expulsion, and also restricting the trading activities by denying them trading licenses in many parts of the country, and generally carrying out a propaganda which was anti-Asian, and also there was discrimination in jobs, in employment. Asians were not able to get jobs under the pretext of Africanization. The government had a policy of Africanization, so Africans came first and the Asians came last in the queue. So things were not good at the time. And when Idi Amin staged his coup in January 1971, I think, yes, thereabouts, the people of Buganda, where I lived, were jubilant because they saw in Idi Amin a redeemer who'd got rid of a despot, a dictator, a brutal person like Milton Obote, who'd unleashed the army on the people. And the army had been continually harassing not only the Asians, but the African populations too, looting them, harassing them, and generally being brutal towards them. So there was a sense of relief in the country with Idi Amin's arrival, and we celebrated. I was involved in celebrations as well. But quite soon, in a few months' time, Idi Amin turned his attention to the Asians and began threatening them with expulsion. Now, the principal reason for this was that when Idi Amin staged the coup, he was a favorite of the British government. Britain was the first country to recognize Idi Amin's regime. He was their boy, and therefore they patted him on the back. And when Idi Amin came to London, he, I think, lunched or dined with the Queen at Buckingham Palace. He was wined and dined throughout his stay in London. And on top of that, he was promised an aid of £10 million, which he was delighted to announce in Uganda on his return. Soon, Uganda's coffers began to run dry, there was no money left, and Idi Amin began to demand from Britain the £10 million they had promised him. Of course, Britain said, no, we're not going to give you cash. We'll run some projects for you. We'll build some projects for you, and that's how the money will come to you. Now, Idi Amin was simple in that sense. If you promised him money, he wanted money. Do you know what he used to do? He used to walk into the State Bank of Uganda in the heart of Kampala and go and open the drawers of the bank, and wherever he found dollar notes, pound notes, he'd pick them up, put them in stuff his pockets with all these currency notes and go away. He was not accountable to anyone. So that's how he understood money. So that aggravated the situation considerably between Idi Amin and Britain. And he began to threaten the Ugandan Asians, and he told Britain that he'll teach them a lesson which they'll not forget for the rest of their lives if they did not honour the commitment of the £10 million they'd promised him. Britain thought that he was bluffing. He could not be serious. He was a buffoon. He was illiterate, he was uneducated, and he was a buffoon. That's how they treated him, because they thought he was their boy all the time. Idi Amin meant business, and he carried out his threat, because in the meantime, he found Muhammad Gaddafi of Libya, who promised to give him as much money as he wanted. And Britain still never took him seriously. That's how the crisis precipitated. But before that, when the things had been boiling, before he made the announcement of the expulsion, in December 1971, I and 12 other members of the Asian community, who were also leaders of the different groups, we were invited to the State House for a meeting at Entebbe with Idi Amin. We lunched with him lavishly, and we had a long meeting with him in which I took the leading part in the discussions. He had all his generals, a lot of his generals present at the meeting. The cabinet ministers were there. He introduced us to them, and our meeting lasted quite some time. And after the meeting, he promised me, he said, "Manzoor, I now understand the Asian situation, and in the future, whenever I take any decision about the Asian community, I will always consult you, because you are the leaders of the community, and I'll always consult you." So we went away quite satisfied that he had managed to diffuse the anti-Asian propaganda that was being carried out so extensively in Uganda by Idi Amin's people in the country. But when we gathered for debriefing at a hotel in Entebbe, we knew in our minds that all we had succeeded in doing was to buy some time, possibly 2 years. But our fate had been sealed. The Asians had no future in Uganda. That was absolutely certain in our minds. And we departed. And then, of course, in August, he made this bombshell announcement of the expulsion. And before that, I had met him a number of times in my hometown, in Masaka. I'd spoken to him. He sat with me at Muslim Mauludis, to know where we celebrated the birthday of the Prophet. We had big feasts. He sat next to me. We talked. We ate together. We sat on the floor. And I met him once or twice again. So I knew him from close quarters. And that's how I knew his attitude. And all this time, he'd carried out severe brutalities against his own people. People who opposed him, he eliminated them. He got them bumped off by his henchmen. And that's how he survived. So this far, and then of course things developed afterwards.
So you had met with Amin and bought some time, you said.
Yes.
When did you finally realise that the time was up in relation to he was going to kick out the Ugandan Asians?
After a meeting at the State House, as I said earlier, in a debriefing meeting of the Asian leaders, we were convinced that the Asian community had no future in Uganda. They could be there for another 2 or 3 years, but they should start making preparations for departing Uganda and finding a place elsewhere, either come to Britain or go to India or Pakistan or Canada, whatever they could do. We are certain of that. But unfortunately, in the meantime, his needs for cash became very urgent, and he kept on demanding this money from Britain, and Britain would not cough up the money. So he then began this threat of expulsion. He started threatening, first of all. He threatened and threatened, and Britain never took him seriously. They thought he was bluffing, because he was their man, and they could deal with him, and he wouldn't carry out the threat. But he was quite serious, because he was facing financial crisis. He had to pay his army soldiers. He had to buy them whiskey all the time. He had to feed them. And he had also to give some hope to the Africans of the country that they'll become wealthy. And the only way he could do this was by giving some indication that he would carry out a massive robbery of the Asian assets by expelling them from the country. And that began to change the equation in the country. And he then finally made the announcement in the first week of August of expulsion. Now, I had been away from Uganda for about a month. I left Uganda in the middle of June, and arrived back at the end of July. I was attending a convention in Mexico City with my wife, and we took the opportunity of touring around the United States and Canada, many European countries, returning to Uganda at the end of July. And then as soon as I returned, I found that my father was very ill and he needed treatment, and his consultant, who used to come to Kampala once a month, was based in Nairobi. So I flew out to Nairobi with my father. And whilst my father was in the hospital, I heard the announcement, whilst I was in Nairobi, that the Asians were going to be expelled and they had to leave the country in 90 days' time. And those who did not return to Kampala, Uganda, would not be allowed to return to Uganda. So I hurriedly made arrangements to go back to Uganda and face the situation. And that's what happened with the expulsion order.
And Manzoor, when did you then... So let's take you back to when, as you are leaving the country, when did you exactly leave and what was your experience of exiting Uganda?
Yes. Now, I was thrown in a quandary like everybody else was. It was traumatic for everyone. It was most unexpected, and it's a great shock which people could not absorb for quite some time. And then I began to think in terms of leaving the country and seeking a new home in Canada, because I liked Canada, I had friends in Canada. I'd passed through Canada on my way back from Mexico. I'd passed through Leicester, in fact. I had a dear friend in Leicester. I passed through Leicester as well in July 1972. And as I began to make preparations, having been in a state of depression, I must say I was in a state of depression. I was really lost. I did not know what to do. But then I decided that I had to leave the country. And my father was there. My brothers and sisters were there in Uganda. So I went to Kampala to see the Canadian embassy for a visa. But before I could meet them, I met a dear friend of mine in Kampala who informed me confidentially that my name was on Idi Amin's hit list for being killed, for being eliminated. So that came as a great shock to me, and I returned to my home immediately. I began to make inquiries. And yes, they were confirmed that I was on the hit list amongst other people, and I would be killed by his henchman who was based in Masaka, a guy called Maliamungu, who was the commander of the barracks in Masaka. So when I was convinced that this was so, I began to make arrangements to depart for Britain. So because I had visited Britain on my way back to Mexico, I had a proper visa to enter Britain at the time. And I went and saw the British High Commission in Kampala, and they said, you can enter Britain without any difficulty. So I then, in the middle of the night, with my wife and my three children, took a drive from Masaka to Entebbe. My father drove us, and I took a midnight flight from there on a Lufthansa aircraft to Frankfurt. There were no flights available to London. All the flights were going full all the time. I could only get 5 seats in a Lufthansa aircraft. I flew to Frankfurt, and from Frankfurt I arrived in London. A few days after my arrival in the UK, I learned that a dear friend of mine, Francis Walugembe, a Ugandan African, who was once a minister in the Kabaka's government and a very influential politician, and a dear friend of mine, had been brutally murdered by Maliamungu in Masaka. And this Francis Alugembe, a few days before my departure from Uganda, had come to see me one evening, sat with me for 3 hours, and he talked and talked, and he told me confidentially. He said, "Look, Manzoor, I'm in touch with Idi Amin. He's promised to make me the governor of a new province, which he'll create out of carving Buganda and Ankole, two adjoining districts. But educated people have no future in this country. People like you and me should make ourselves scarce from the scene. We should disappear for a while." That's what he told me in my office. But I had known before that that my life was in danger. But I didn't tell him that I had information about my being in danger. So he confirmed that. And he was brutally killed a few days later by the same person who would have got me, Maliamungu. So that's how brutal Idi Amin was. He had the knack of affability. He was a very affable person. He disarmed people by his laughter, by joviality, by patting you on the back. And whilst he was disarming you, he might be scheming to brutally eliminate you. That's what he was doing. So that's what he did to Francis Walugembe. That was my experience of him. So I left Uganda in very difficult circumstances. I did not even tell anybody else, apart from my father who knew, and one or two other people, one of my brothers knew, and one of my staff members knew that I was leaving the country. Nobody knew. I left my house as it was, as if it was being lived in. I left everything as it was, my vehicles, my house, my office, everything. That's how I fled the country in the middle of the night on 9th September, arriving in the UK on 10th September 1972.
And with such a, if I use the term, traumatic removal of yourself, yes, from Uganda, what legacy did that leave on you emotionally in the trauma of that upheaval?
Yes. I was distraught. Quite frankly, I didn't realize at the time, depression was not common. The word was not common in the 70s, even in Britain. But I must have been in a state of depression. I was terribly upset. I did not know what to do. And the worst thing was that in the meantime, whilst all this nonsense was going on in Uganda, the British press were carrying stories of some 80,000 Asians descending on Britain and making life difficult for the British people, as Britain did not have any accommodation for them in the country. And this went on and on. And when we had a meeting with Idi Amin at his command post, where I was the Asian leader, the British High Commissioner, Richard Slater, after Idi Amin said he was expelling us all, the British High Commissioner had nothing to say except in a very, very weak, and I would say very weak voice, very wimpish voice. All he said was, "I will consult my government about the number of people we can take in, full stop." That's all he said. I could have said a lot of things, but I knew it was futile, because Idi Amin's mind had been made up, and he came to tell us once again the action he was taking. The Pakistani High Commissioner had nothing to say, the Indian High Commissioner had nothing to say, and the other people just sat. They had no role to play. I could have said something, but I knew if I said something, I was already in the limelight. Because in December 1971, I've talked about the meeting at the Entebbe House. How did that happen? How did he come to invite us? You have not asked me, but I'll tell you why. Mm. In 1971, December, Idi Amin invited Asian delegations from all the towns in Uganda to come to a conference at the Nile Center, a big conference center which is now a hotel, to attend a meeting which he was going to address. So all the district commissioners in the different towns selected Asian delegations from people who went there to see him. Now, I didn't want to be part of the delegation, but I was chosen. So I was to lead my delegation from Osaka. So we arrived at the conference in Kampala. We were housed at the top hotel, Apollo Hotel in Kampala, by the government. The hall was full, packed. There were diplomats from all over the world who had embassies in Kampala. They were present. All the generals were there. All the VIPs in Uganda were there. And we all awaited. And we all had come with our own pieces to address the conference, to congratulate him and express our hope that he would help the Asian community to build Uganda together, because we are prepared to invest, to work with him, and to take Uganda to further heights of achievement. So we are all in a jovial mood, in a mood of expectancy, of great hope for Idi Amin. So we waited. When he arrived, resplendent in his military uniform, he attacked the Asian community in the most vituperative, most poisonous language, accused us of all kinds of malpractices, of having two sets of books, of being traitors to Uganda, of salting money out of the country, of not giving Asian girls in marriage to the Africans, of being disloyal to Uganda, and sabotaging the economy of Uganda, and not giving the premises on rent to the Ugandan African traders. And that shook us, you know. I mean, that was the most shocking attack he made against the Asian community. So we were all completely taken aback, all of us. Now, all our little addresses disappeared because they were no use. So suddenly, we had to come together. So they all came to me. Manzoor, will you be our spokesman? Can you respond to that, please? Now, I said, all right. And then, having addressed us, he left us. He didn't stay in the conference. Mm. But we are supposed to respond. Mm. So I responded, extempore. And I responded in a most diplomatic way and dismantled most of the accusations he had made, but without any heat in them, without any causing any offense to anyone, systematically, logically, and in a scientific manner, I proved that there was no truth in them. Mm-hmm. And then we were invited to lunch at the State House that day. And before the lunch, we did a TV program. UTV was Uganda's television station. And there was a very famous African journalist who interviewed us. And I was amongst a panel of five Asian leaders. And I was the spokesman. And in the television interview, I dismantled once again all of Idi Amin's arguments in a most inoffensive manner. Now, that had wide coverage in Uganda. And that, I think, quietened Idi Amin. In December 1971, he might have wanted to take some precipitate action against the Asian community.
Interesting.
But because we were able to thwart his efforts by our arguments against his accusations, which were unfounded, he kept quiet. And then he invited us to this conference, to this meeting at the State House. The State House meeting with him was the result of this conference, which we attended, in which he made all kinds of accusations, and I was able to dismantle them. So I was very well known, and therefore, when it came to the last meeting at the command post, I did not want to put myself in more limelight, mm-hmm. because I was afraid of the repercussions, of the consequences. And when I left the State House, I came downstairs. There was BBC and other media were there. They wanted my comments. And I said, no comment. Mm-hmm. I made no comment and walked away from there. And that was the most sensible thing. If I had made any comments during the meeting, he would have found it offensive, because mm-hmm. I would have had to disagree with him. Mm-hmm. And that would have made things worse for me. But yeah. with me, whenever I talked to him, we talked on friendly terms, but he was not friendly. He was a dangerous man behind the facade of friendliness, which he exuded whenever he wanted to. He was a most dangerous and brutal person who would eliminate people without any compunction. But he wouldn't do it himself. He had his henchman, Maliamungu, being the number one henchman who did his dirty work.
Mm. Now, one of the things, Manzoor, you highlighted to me was the fact that you were the only Ugandan Asian to then meet Amin in 1984 in Saudi Arabia. And you had a 5-6 hour conversation over a meal with him. What did Amin reflect back in that meeting to you? Because this is a unique piece of history here.
It is indeed. I was in Saudi Arabia in 1984 with my wife. We'd gone to see a friend of ours, who was a doctor, who was a friend from Uganda, a very close friend. So we'd gone to see him, and of course we performed Umrah, mini Hajj, in Mecca at the time, which was something which we enjoyed, and it was a very wonderful experience of doing Umrah. And then we talked about Uganda. We knew that Idi Amin was the guest of the King of Saudi Arabia and was resident in a villa in Jeddah. Mm. We knew that. So we thought, well, I said, why not arrange a meeting to see Idi Amin? And we found someone who had some contacts with Idi Amin's villa and the staff, and he agreed to be the go-between. So somehow we managed to arrange a meeting for me. I gave him my name, who I was, and Idi Amin knew me. So meeting was agreed. Surprise, surprise, we didn't think he'd agree. It's a wild shot it was. We didn't think he'd agree. But he agreed to a meeting. So my friend and I, the two of us, and this intermediary, we travelled to his villa, which was some distance from where we lived. We parked outside his villa, and there was a sentry, an armed sentry outside his villa, mm-hmm. who came to see us, and we identified ourselves. Then he talked to Idi Amin through his system, and our entry was okay. So he took us all the way into the villa. We had a long walk and before we reached his room. And as we entered the room, of course, we embraced. He came out and embraced. And he was a big man, you know, 6'3", tall, 6'4", and huge for us. We embraced. So I said, how are you, Mr. President? And he said, I'm very well, thank you, Manzoor. So I called him Mr. President. And he was flattered. He was very pleased. He was very pleased when I said, Mr. President. So we sat down. He said, sit down, please. It was his in his lounge. So we sat down and we started talking. We exchanged views. And as we talked, he then invited some of his other colleagues who were also resident in Jeddah. He had a cabinet in waiting, so his potential prime minister, he invited him to come, and two or three other African politicians who had joined him in Jeddah, they all came along to his house. He then ordered his sons to ask their mother to make a meal for us, so we are dining together, we're dining with him. So we said, all right. So we dined at about, I think we arrived at his villa at 7 in the evening, and we dined at 10. Mm. We had some lamb curry and some other food. So we enjoyed the meal as well, and we talked, and we stayed with him up to 1 o'clock in the morning. So we had a 6-hour meeting. And for 6 hours we talked and talked and talked. And one of the things he said to me during the 6-hour meeting, and we discussed politics of Uganda, we discussed politics of Africa, of Britain, and he was conversant with politics of many countries. And he was well informed about Uganda's situation in detail. And he was planning a comeback. Mm. He had some forces in neighboring Congo, and Mobutu was his friend. So Mobutu was the president of Zaire at the time, what is now DRC. Mobutu was his friend, Joseph Mobutu, Colonel Joseph Mobutu. So he was hoping to launch an attack across the border and re-enter Uganda. So he talked about that too. And then along the way, he said, look, Manzoor, when you go back to Britain, tell all Ugandan friends, Asian friends, to go back to Uganda. Tell them to go back to Uganda. And he repeated that 2 or 3 times. Now, this was his way of acknowledging the mistake he had made in expelling them. This was his way of apologizing for what he had done by encouraging them to go back to Uganda, because he realized the folly of the action he had taken and the damage he had done to Uganda, which remained, Uganda remained in doldrums for many, many years, because when in 1992, I went back to Uganda as part of a radio documentary program. I found the country in a terribly devastated state. The buildings were dilapidated, they're falling to pieces, the roads were full of potholes, the services were absolutely non-existent. If you went to the toilets of any public building, for example, Uganda Radio, I was doing a broadcast from there in 1992. And I happened to want to use the gents' facility. And I was directed in the evening time. The bulbs were not working, there was no lighting, it was darkness, so I had to walk in the darkness. And when I opened the door to the gents, I had to run away from there. The smell was so overpowering that you could not stand there for a minute. It was that filthy it was. And that's Uganda Broadcasting House it was. Mm. That was the state of the country in 1992. And that was the result of Idi Amin's doings, because of the way he had run down the country. So he would have realized the damage he had done to the country because of his misrule. And he apologized in that manner to the Ugandan Asian community by asking me to tell them to return to Uganda. So we left at 1 o'clock. So when we left, he walked with us all the way, and along the way he showed me, he said, look, Manzoor, I've grown matoke here. Matoke is, well, you know what matoke is? Cassava. He said, look, I'm growing matoke. He showed me these, matoke is plantain.
Yeah, plantain, like banana. That's right.
Then he showed me mogo. It's cassava. Look, I'm growing mogo here, and there's matoke here, and then he came with me all the way to the car. He opened the door for me. I sat on the back seat. We embraced. He embraced all three of us, and we said goodbye. He shut my door. We said goodbye, and off we went. So that was the meeting I had with him, and nothing productive would have come out of it, because he had no power.
Yeah.
Saudi Arabia had stopped making any press statements. He was not allowed to make any press statements or any statements of any kind. So, but he was alert. As we were coming out of his house, he passed a room and he showed me a blackboard. And on the blackboard, he showed me, he said, look, this is German. I'm learning German language. I've got a German teacher, because he was a great admirer of Adolf Hitler. Right. Idi Amin openly admired Adolf Hitler.
Right.
And he was learning the German language.
Yeah, so he was quite open to learning.
Yes, yes. He was very alert. I tell you, he was so alert. The British people, of course, propagated the myth deliberately to ruin his reputation by saying that he was a patient of syphilis, and syphilis had gone to his head.
Right.
He was syphilitic, but he was alert. He knew what was going on in the world. He was cunning. He could plan. He could execute. And he was learning German in 1984 when I visited him. And he gave me a rundown on politics in Uganda, in Zaire, in Britain. He was very alert. And he was planning even at the time. But because the Saudis would not encourage him in any planning, I think he was seriously thwarted in mounting a real attack on Uganda from Zaire.
Yes.
He had no support from the Saudi government. And in fact, he was an embarrassment for them. The only reason they welcomed him was because he was a Muslim and he promised to convert Uganda into a Muslim nation.
Right.
And they were hopeful that he would do so.
So that was the primary reason they took him in?
Yeah. Oh. And so was Gaddafi. Was Gaddafi. For the same reason, Gaddafi thought that here was an African country which Idi Amin would convert to a Muslim state, not knowing that Uganda's Muslim population was only 15 to 20% at best. 80% of the rest were Catholics or Protestants.
So badly misjudged.
Misjudged, but that's how they were. So he was quite crafty in that sense. He was not syphilitic. He was not a buffoon. And his memory was quite intact. And he was planning cunningly all the time. And his brutality never diminished. But what I realized was that he did understand the blunder he had committed, because the Asian community would have been the strongest pillar for the economic survival, stability and development of Uganda. Had he enlisted the support, we would have been the greatest asset for Uganda. And Uganda would have been a shining example of prosperity and stability, and it would have truly been the pearl of Africa, as Winston Churchill said many years ago when he paid a visit to Uganda. Yes, Uganda is still the pearl of Africa for a tourist. But not from the point of view of politics, or governance, or stability, or prosperity. But it is prosperous. Do you know what Uganda's population now is?
No.
47 million.
Wow, I didn't realize. From
when we left Uganda, Uganda's population was about 12 million. And what is most significant to know is that the total population of the Asians in Uganda in 1972 was around 35,000 people only. It had declined from 60,000 in 1962 to 35,000. And of those, some 10,000 went to Canada and European countries and United States because they were rendered stateless mostly.
Yes.
A few hundred went to India and Pakistan because they carried those passports. The majority of 24 to 25,000 people who held British passports came to Britain. Now, the British High Commission in Uganda knew very well what the numbers were because they are the ones who were in charge of immigration at the time for the British citizens. And yet, despite that knowledge they had, they never corrected the British news media, which is flagging up 80,000 people.
That's right.
Even Richard Slater never mentioned that figure. The question you want to ask is, why did they not disclose this information to the media and say, look, shut up. You are exaggerating. You are creating hysteria amongst the people. You don't need to do that. Numbers are very small. They're manageable numbers. Britain's population in 1972 was 55 million. Today it's 67 million. They've only grown 12 million in 50 years' time.
Yes.
It's a minuscule growth.
Yes.
And yet, these people shouting, overcrowding, no places in schools, no places in social services, no housing, nothing, nothing, nothing. And Leicester was in the forefront of making this announcement by telling the Ugandan Nations not to come to Leicester because there was nothing for them in Leicester.
Yeah.
And what happens? Because of this announcement which they made publicly in newspapers in Uganda and East Africa, the Ugandan Nations who were expelled came to see Leicester out of curiosity. Why am I being discouraged from going into Leicester? So when they came here, they found the nucleus of an Asian community, well established, Asian corner shops, Asian ration shops, Asian Hindu temples, Sikh Gurdwara, Muslim mosque. So they found a well-knit community. So naturally, they were attracted to come and settle here. And they did not bother about being housed by the British authorities who ran camps in various places. They came to Leicester. Some 6,000 plus people came out of 25 to 30% of the Ugandan Nations came to Leicester for this very reason. And it backfired on Leicester City Council. That's what happened. But the question you want to ask is, why did the British High Commission in Uganda not disclose the correct figure to somewhat mitigate the hysteria in the press? They had a duty to do so. And the other thing is, when they found that Idi Amin was serious in his intentions to expel the Ugandan Nations, why did they never ever call the Asian leaders to come and sit with them so they could discuss their future in terms of their exodus from Uganda? Because the Asians were being expelled from Uganda, and their exodus was a direct responsibility of the British government through the High Commission. The High Commission never approached us for a meeting to discuss these issues. On the other hand, if you lived in Kampala in those days, you would have found long queues of Asian men, women and children queuing outside the British High Commission, staying there at nights also, and being laughed at by Uganda's army generals. And Idi Amin used to drive by just to have fun to see the pitiable state of the once prosperous Ugandan community being belittled in this horrific manner, where they stood like beggars for British visas on passports which were proper British passports, but for the 1968 legislation approved by a Labour government under Roy Jenkins, Home Secretary, who was Home Secretary, they brought in the 1968 Immigration Act. Now, that was the humiliation which the Asians underwent at the hands of the African generals, Idi Amin. For what? The British High Commission remained very unhelpful in these matters. Where was the need for visas? They all had proper British passports. So why did you want to stamp the passports and visas? The question. Yeah. They were not British protected citizens. They were proper British citizens with full rights, except for that foolish legislation which was discriminatory in 1968.
Indeed.
By all accounts.
Indeed.
It was an act of discrimination by the government.
Indeed.
That's what they did. So the Asians got a raw deal. And of course, the next question you may want to ask is how the Asians have done. The Asians who come from the Indian subcontinent, which is India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and of course you might include Sri Lanka, they're enterprising people. You go anywhere in any part of the world, you find that these Asians are enterprising. They start small businesses, they grow and grow. I mean, I went to this Montego Bay in Jamaica some years ago. Montego Bay is a holiday resort, and we went with a group of people. And I and my friend, along with our wives, we went to a Jamaican farm to see how farming was done. And on our way back, we felt a little hungry, so we told the van driver to see if there was an eating place somewhere along the way. So he brought us to a place where there was a Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC was there. So we tucked into KFC, and then just nearby, there was a jeweler's shop, quite a big jeweler's shop. So we walked in, and there was an Asian owner of the jeweler's shop. It's a beautiful shop with gold, diamonds, pearls being exhibited in beautiful showcases on sale. And we had long talk with him. He had come from India and established a jeweler's shop there. And my friend bought some pearls from him. And my friend, who had previously run a jeweler's shop in London, knew what he was buying, and they were genuine things. And nearby, there was an Asian shop selling garments and garments and fabrics, also doing good business. So they were doing business in those remote areas, in Montego Bay area. So it doesn't matter where you go to a place like Vanuatu, is an island some miles away from Australia. You find Asian shopkeepers. They're enterprising. So the Asians who came here, despite the trauma they suffered, settled down, and they've prospered like all other communities have prospered. The Afghans have prospered, the Iraqis have prospered, the Turks have prospered, the Zimbabweans have prospered, the South Africans have prospered, the Syrians have prospered lately. Yeah. So they all prosper because they all work hard. They're enterprising people. So that's the nature of our Asian community, is to work hard and to prosper. So that's been the outcome. So in that respect, the younger generation have been very fortunate in receiving education and all the other benefits in this country. But many of the older generation who were well off, they suffered massively. The poorer people, the lower middle class people in the Asian community who came from Uganda, they did not suffer because they had no job prospects. Many were unemployed, or they were not able to find employment. They were living hand to mouth. So the expulsion opened up a new opportunity for them in a westernized country. They didn't care too much about discrimination here, which was rife in this country. I mean, discrimination was so rife in Britain in 1972 that you could cut the atmosphere with a knife. Mm-hmm. It's that raw it was in this country. It was terrible. So they didn't care about it. But the upper middle class and the richer class, they were most affected by Idi Amin's expulsion. And some of my friends passed away of heart attack and strokes because of the traumas they suffered, the shocks they had. My father was hale and hearty. You know, my father never drank, never smoked. He was physically fit. I was one of the fittest person that I'd ever seen in my life. He passed away at the age of 69.
Wow.
He should have lived up to a riper old age. But he lost everything. He'd built everything from scratch. He had nothing in Uganda. He was employed once. He left employment and built all these things single-handedly. And my father was uneducated. He did not know how to read and write English. Mm-hmm. He could hardly sign his name in English.
Yeah.
Hardly. He learned how to sign his name in English. So he died prematurely. Mm. So those are shocks that people never talk about.
Tell me, Manzoor, you've raised a really, really important point that many overlook, is the
yes.
impact on longevity.
Yes.
People losing their lives early because of the trauma and the stress.
Yes.
But, you know, you went through, and I'm just reflecting back on what you said.
Yes.
You went through having to leave the country that you had grown up in, immediately.
Yes.
And to leave, as you said, everything behind in a house that looked like it was still lived in.
Yes.
And when you landed in the UK, it was clearly not a rosy picture. You just talked about racism being endemic in society.
Yes.
What were your experiences early in the first 2 years of trying to settle here in a completely different landscape?
I didn't want to settle here. I didn't like Leicester, I didn't like Britain, because this was a very racist country. Racism was rife, and talked about in the media. The people showed it in their faces. And because I am a different kind of person, I did not directly suffer any discrimination because I would put them in the place in no time. For example, I was, after, I think a few years, late in the 70s, early in the 80s, I was attending a big meeting at the town hall, outside the town hall. The meeting had something to do with signing a charter which wanted the developed countries to give 0.75% of the GDP to the poorer countries. You see, and they were called G7 at the time, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And there was a big thing that we had to sign. Mm-hmm. So we are sitting on chairs outside, and this must be the late 70s, I think. Possibly late 70s, I think. So we sat there, and there was this middle-aged woman next to me, an indigenous person. I don't like color coding. I'm against color coding. Mm. So indigenous person sitting next to me. And of course there are Asian leaders who were also asked to go up and sign this pledge urging these G7 countries to allocate 0.75% of the GDP to the poorer countries. Yeah? So these are all from India and Pakistan, so they spoke English in a poor way. They were not, they're all workers, you know, they'd come as workers, they were manual workers, most of them. So English naturally was not brilliant, they spoke poor English. And this woman said, oh, you know, I had not talked much to her, but she made a comment to me, she said, oh, you know, these Asians, they speak very poor English, they can hardly express themselves. Something derogatory, she said. So I kept quiet, I just smiled at her. So my name was announced to go and speak. So I always speak extempore, I make speeches, I never read speeches at all. So I went up to the thing to sign, and I spoke extempore. I spoke about politics in Britain and the poor countries, etc. And when I came and sat back, this woman was looking at me with mouth open. So she didn't expect that any person who was not of her color could speak English so well in a place like Leicester, of all the places, which was rife with racism. We had the worst of the lot in Leicester.
Right.
The worst of the lot. So then she starts saying, oh, were you educated? She started naming some British universities. And I said, no, I don't know. And then I said, to put it in place, I said, look, I was educated at the Punjab University in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. They shut up. So that was the level of ignorance. I mean, she was not trying to be offensive to me. I don't think so.
Yeah.
It was level of ignorance. They're totally ignorant about the Asian community because they thought that these people are coming from the jungle.
Yeah.
Perhaps they had just recently descended from the trees and they did not speak English. Little did they know that the pattern of governance in Uganda was similar to what we have in Britain, because Uganda was a British protectorate and the governance was based on British systems. Completely. The education was based on British education systems. For example, we took the Cambridge University exam when we did our OA levels. We took the Cambridge University exam.
Wow.
Our exams were set by Cambridge University. The papers came from Cambridge to Kampala.
Wow.
And we wrote our exams on that basis. And they were also marked in Cambridge. They were not marked in Uganda.
Interesting.
You see?
Yeah.
So they didn't know this. They were ignorant completely. And all the racism, most of that was based on ignorance and media hysteria. Mm. And of course the racists who were enjoying, were basking in this great hysteria because this was being triumphant for them. They were triumphant that they succeeded in mounting such a campaign against the Asians. Mm. That's how it was. So I had no intention of settling down here. I didn't like this country. But then, because, and I went to Canada. Mm-hmm. I took my family, my wife, my children, and I wanted to emigrate from here to Canada. But because my wife was unwilling. Her mother, her parents were here, her brothers and sisters were in the UK, and that was the pull she had. She didn't disclose to me at the time. We had only been married for a few years then, so there was not that candid discussion between ourselves, maybe. I'm only guessing. So that prevented me from going away from here. But once I settled down here, I took active part after a few years in many things. I became a justice of the peace, which I served for many years. I was chairman of my court for 10 years. And I set examples in the court which they'd never seen before, because I talked extempore all the time. I addressed all the prisoners directly. I addressed all the barristers and solicitors, the probation officers. I did not read from the written text because I knew what they were. And I spoke them verbatim without looking at them. You see? So I changed standards there. And I stood for Parliament when SDP was formed. I was a founder member of the Social Democratic Party. And I went to the conferences. I addressed the conferences many times. I was on the national executive of the SDP.
Wow.
And so I did. And then, of course, life went on, and I settled down in Leicester. And then, of course, my life has been full of variety. I've written articles. I've written books. I've lectured at universities, I've lectured to groups of people, and generally it's been enjoyable, I would think, although one can always say it could have been much better, but that's human nature. Not to be satisfied, it is human nature.
Indeed.
So I've had the privilege of wearing four different hats.
That's amazing.
In a way.
In a lifetime.
In a lifetime. And my last hat is being British. And I'm proud to be British. I've enjoyed being British. And this is my home now. This is my home now. So, but I have not forgotten the way the British government reacted to the announcement here in Britain, the House of Commons. The reaction was, we can't take them all. Douglas Hume was then the Foreign Secretary. Edward Heath was the Prime Minister, and their immediate reaction was, oh, we can't handle so many people, this is not possible, this is not possible. And it was not one of understanding and compassion and sympathy for a people
indeed
who were being made homeless overnight.
Who are British citizens?
I mean, there's no human element. It's only their own politics, their own convenience, their own reaction. And behind it all was a psyche of racism which never goes away. It always works behind the scenes. Even today, it hasn't gone away. It works very strongly. For many years, I was the chairman of Leicestershire County Council's Race Relations Committee.
Right.
And I formed a group of people with power, delegated to us by the County Council in partnership with them, equal partnership, which never existed in Britain ever. And it has never existed anywhere else. We were the only ones, and we changed the face of race relations in Leicester when people started saying that Leicester is an example of good race relations. Why? Because we worked at it. And we worked at it not under the Commission of Racial Equality, CRE, who were nothing but just bureaucratic and a tool of the government, mouthpiece of the government to assuage the minorities and to keep them in their place and make money themselves, being paid fat salaries, fat allowances all the time. And we worked ceaselessly without being paid. No money changed hands. We are not paid by anyone. We met ministers, we changed the policies, we changed the policy council. I chaired meetings with the county council where people from all over the country came. I addressed them in the county hall many times. I have the capacity to chair meetings of any number of people. And we changed the atmosphere here. And of course, Leicester City Council, which is always problematic, then of course was able to take the credit for it, because it's Leicester, isn't it?
That's right.
So we don't mind. We're happy that somebody takes credit, because we did the job for them.
That's right.
So somebody takes credit. But then You can never eliminate racism completely from any society.
Correct.
This is my belief. No matter how hard you try, historically, these things linger on and on.
Yeah.
And they metamorphose into different shapes and sizes. They camouflage themselves sometimes differently, but they don't disappear. In Britain, it's been camouflaged now, completely, and it's failed again. Why? Because camouflage is a camouflage. It's not reality.
You see? That's right. That's right.
So it's failed.
That's right.
But that's not to say that they're not people of goodwill. There are many people of goodwill in this country. Many people. At the same time, there are many people, for example, the present atmosphere in the country lends itself to racism, and it's being exploited to the nth degree by politicians for their own purposes, for electoral gain. They're doing it already.
Manzoor, listening to you is like an encyclopedia of knowledge, if I may honestly, it's an encyclopedia of knowledge, particularly around one of the most disturbing areas of history that impacted you directly and in a way indirectly impacted me as a child of a Ugandan Asian and having been born in Uganda in Fort Portal. I guess one of the things that I'm slightly concerned with is that the children of those of Ugandan heritage are not taking much interest in their own heritage. What would you say to them?
I think the problem is they're being sucked into a consumer society where the only criteria is finding good jobs, employment, and all the education they receive is for opening up opportunities of employment and jobs. So they're being slotted in. Education no longer seeks knowledge. Knowledge is a byproduct only of university education. It is not the purpose. The purpose of university education is to slot them into different jobs for corporate organizations who continue to mint money, make billions. And they facilitate that. So in that exercise, they're so busy that they haven't got the time to study history. History is something that they don't know. And they are made to forget history conveniently, because otherwise they would not think so kindly of the corporations who exploit them and exploit their expertise. So it's done deliberately, and the younger generation has got sucked into it because they haven't got the time. They think that the stories they heard from the parents were perhaps fiction, the parents were uneducated, they're illiterate, for example, and their nostalgia is just nostalgia, it's got no reality in it. And that is a misfortune, because they do not have any central organization of Ugandan Asians in this country, which they should have created. We had one in Uganda. We had an Asian association, for example, and I was an active member of the Asian association, so which included Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs from all over the country. That's how we were able to mount a leadership amongst the Asians. Now that's not here. Here we've got split into Hindus and Muslims and Sikhs and Parsis and all these little factions, and they've got bogged down in their spare time in their own cultures, which are more for symbolic purposes and sometimes more for other reasons. But as far as history is concerned, they're bereft of true historical knowledge. And that's lacking. People who don't understand history, they do not understand what knowledge is. Knowledge is based on history. The more history you know, the better able you are to understand what knowledge means and how to apply. Nobody wants to apply knowledge. They want to apply skills. Now, there's a difference between skills and knowledge. Skills are meant for a specific purpose to achieve a specific target. And that's for your employers. Employers are the masters. All the employees and the young people who are mostly employees are there to serve the larger purpose for their masters. And therefore, they do not care for the history of their parents. And that's very sad, because their parents had a rich history. Remember, 70% plus of the buildings in East Africa, if not more, were built by their parents. All the buildings in the cities in Tanzania, in Kenya, in Uganda, were built by the parents through the hard work. Not by the Africans, not by the Europeans. The Europeans, the British people, they only built some landmark big buildings for their own headquarters. And they're few and far between. There were not many. All the residential, the commercial, the shop premises, the cinemas, the theatres, the cultural centres, the temples, the mosques, the gurdwaras, they're all built by the Asians with their own money. With their own money. So our contribution was enormous. Absolutely enormous contribution. If they let it go by, then they are not doing a service to themselves, and they are not reminding the Africans that they owe a debt of massive gratitude to the Asian community, without whom they would not have prospered. They would not have been where they are now without them. The Asians were the pillars of their economy, the pillars of their commerce, the pillars of their stability, and they helped the Africans. If the African got sick in a village, the Indian shopkeeper was waking up at midnight, he'd come out and he'd bring out his little van, put the sick patient in the van, take him to the hospital 20 miles away at midnight and not charge him a single penny and come back home and sleep. On top of that, he'd provide food for the patient. On top of that. Now, these are services which have been forgotten. Who was he? He was their father in the village. He would provide money for the Africans, for the patients, transport them, and charge them nothing.
Manzoor, fantastic. All I have to say, it's been a real pleasure to get the breadth of knowledge, but I think the sacredness of your remembrance, that's what I want to call it, because it is a piece of history that must never be forgotten.
Yes.
It's a sacredness of knowledge.